Okay, tonight we're going to be going back to and studying a foundation. One of the basic foundations when it comes to the Christian faith, Christianity, and that is faith. We are going to be looking at faith. Now, when we look at this world, the world we live in, faith is a requirement in absolutely everything. It's not just our Christian faith. When you think about when we first got accepted Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, it first took faith. It took faith in believing that He was the Son of God. It took faith in believing that if we confess our sins, He is truly just to forgive us of our sins. When we look at the world around us, there are people that don't believe in God, but yet they have faith. To the pagan, they have faith in their false or demonic God. To the atheist, to the true atheist, they have faith that there's absolutely nothing. But what we want to look at more so tonight is biblical faith. What do I mean by biblical faith? One thing that has grabbed a hold of me here in the last couple months is the fact of why don't we see signs and wonders all in them that believe? A lot of times, I think it's because of a lack of faith. So we are going to get to the root and look at faith from a novice's standpoint. From, like, we know absolutely nothing when it comes to faith. What is it? So when we look at faith, what are some things that we might start asking ourselves if we're going to start studying what faith is? What are some things we might start asking ourselves? Where what might we start in our adventure, in our study? If you were going to sit down and study faith, where do you start? You start in the mud. So we still have to go a little bit farther. Where are we going? What are we going to do with the Word of God? How are we going to study faith in the Word of God? If you're going to start there, brother, what might be some one of the first things you do with the Word of God? And what would make you go to Hebrews chapter 11? So we might start, let's say we'll investigate Hebrews 11. Maybe John 1?
Yeah.
Where else? What else might we start with? Okay, before we really start into something, into studying something, there's normally some thoughts, some starting points. What might we want to look at? Where might we want to go? And we're looking at it from the aspect of really, we really don't know anything. We want to understand what faith truly is. What's that?
Go to the dictionary, find out what faith is.
Go to the dictionary. So we might go to what? Well, we go to, hopefully, Webster's. We're not going to pull out just any dictionary, but we're going to go to a trusted source. I mean, if we want to get down to in the day and age we live in, there are several different dictionaries, but one of the most reliable we know is Webster, because he goes back to the founding of the United States. He was the first dictionary, so we'll go to Webster's.
Go by the life of Jesus, all the miracles that happened, because it happened by faith.
It happened by faith.
And he said to the blind man, go wash your clothes with Salam. He went, he healed, and by faith, he was healed.
He did. And that's what we're trying to figure out. What is faith? So maybe investigate some things, some of the instances of Jesus' miracles. Now, we're going to back up a little bit. Is there anybody else want to put in any other before we go any farther? Yay, nay.
Hey, it is something I think all for, and I have to get a thing.
Absolutely, brother. Did you have anything, Sister Peterman, or are you just sitting on it right now?
Just sitting on it.
Okay. Anybody else before we move any farther? Okay. I'm gonna back up one moment. I tend to have more of a systematic mind and put things and shuffle things around and try to place things in order. For me, one of the first things I'm going to do is I'm going to see how many times that occurs in the Bible, which is a whole lot easier at home on my computer than it is here, because I can bring up my Bible program, I can type in the word faith, and it will tell me exactly how many times that occurs. Well, let me put it this way. It'll tell me how many verses it occurs in. When we get down to it, we find that there are only two verses in the Old Testament that use the word faith, and 232 verses in the New Testament. Now, that might not seem like much, but that will play a role in our future as we get farther in our study of faith, because it gives us kind of springboard, a logic place to go back to and investigate a little bit farther, because we are trying to find out, what is faith? We don't know what we have ideas, but what is biblical faith? Like I said, it occurs in two verses in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy chapter 32 and verse 20, and Habakkuk 2:4. For the sake of time, and we'll look at it a little bit later, we're not going to go ahead and read those. And it occurs in 232 verses of the New Testament. For the sake of time, we're not even going to venture reading all 232. And everybody said, amen. We only have so much time. But as Sister Tina already said, we're going to go to Webster's Dictionary, because one of the first things we're going to do is we're probably going to try to determine what the definition of faith is. We're going to want a logic board. We don't really know what it means, so we are going to try to get a definition of faith. So when we look at Merriam-Webster's Dictionary, and you'll have to forgive me because we're going to be bouncing back and forth. And it might not be in my notes. Nope, but I have this definition for another one. Okay.
I don't have that name in my notes.
You have your phone? Can I use it?
What?
That was done by faith, but brother, we don't know what faith is. We're trying to get a definition and a meaning. What is biblical faith? Yeah, but we're trying to get to the root of biblical faith. And she's Googling, yeah, we're trying to get to the root of biblical. That's not right. Mary left the dictionary. Faith. Okay, according to Merriam-Webster's online dictionary, faith, an allegiance to duty or person, fidelity to one's promises, belief and trust in loyalty to God, belief in the traditional doctrines of religion, firm belief in something for which there is no proof, something that is believed especially with strong conviction. So that's what Merriam-Webster's dictionary had to say. If we're going to go a little bit farther, we're still going to make sure that we're trying to understand the definition of faith. If we really don't understand what something is or what a word is, that was one of the first things we were taught in school. Find out the definition of it. Somebody, you said a big word, your mom, or somebody might say, well, what does that mean? You know, Macy says a lot of big words, but does she really know what they mean? When you were in school, if you ask your teacher, well, what does that word mean? I don't know about you, but I heard a lot of times, well, go look it up. So you end up in the dictionary. We found out what Webster's dictionary had to say. But we want to find out what the biblical definition of faith is. So we are going to try to find out how the Bible defines faith. Whenever I'm studying the Bible, first thing I'm going to do, one of the first things I'm going to do is try to see does the Bible give a definition for this word, or does it give an interpretation of it? Because the Bible interprets itself time and time again. It's just a matter of knowing where to go. We may not always know where to go, but when we do, we use previous knowledge to get there. What might be one thing? Let me rephrase that. Do any verses come to mind that might define faith? Exactly. Hebrews 11 and verse 1. And what does Hebrews 11, 1 state? Faith is the substance of things hoped for, and we're going to put it in clips, the evidence of things not seen. So if we were going to break this down into the dictionary, instead of using the word is, we might have faith, colon, because the definition for faith, according to the Bible, is faith is the substance of things hoped for. So when we look at faith, it is the substance. When we use the word substance, what does our mind go to? What would substance mean in this case? What would our mind think? Something that's touchable. For me, my mind goes to this. It goes to the makeup of something. The composition. So when I look at, for me, when I look at that word substance, it's more along the lines of makeup and composition. Does anybody else, does anything else come to anyone else's mind? Because for me, substance is something that is not mixing up.
The 14th chapter. Okay, and now faith, I will provide something for God. After that, at the time of fire and stuff, and asking what he allowed. And even that, that was the thing that you eat, because he is not the faith. For whatsoever,
yes. So the thing is, we're trying to figure out what faith is. So we find out that faith is the substance of things hoped for, and it's the evidence of some of things not seen. So when, automatically, from my mind's eye, faith is the substance. So how does the Bible define the substance? And I won't lie, this comes a whole lot easier at home with Power Bible. I have two different programs I use, but the reason Power Bible is so handy is I can do in seconds what people have done, taken minutes and tens of minutes to do in the past. And the first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to look at the Greek. Not that I'm a Greek scholar, but it's going to give me a better definition of the meaning. And when we're using Hebrews chapter 1 as our springboard, it's our launching point. It's the first place that we're going to, because that delivers to us the definition of faith. So if we're going to find out what faith is, it begins right here, because that is where we get our biblical definition of faith. And when we look at, we're bouncing all around here. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. In the Greek, that word for substance is hypostasis. Now, when we look at that, and we start diving into, let me just go back. I think the definition is a little bit further back. Okay, we're good. Okay, when we look at this and we start studying it a little bit farther, corollary commentaries, because I won't lie, I do turn to commentaries to see what they're saying on subjects and so forth. They claim that it means a support. And they base that on the Aristotle's use of the Greek word in some of his writings. Now, the problem with that is Aristotle lived about 300 years after the writing of the New Testament. I want to find out what the biblical definition of faith is. I don't care how Aristotle used it. What I'm going to be looking at, how did Peter use it? How did John use it? How did Paul write it? How did the early apostles use this Greek word in their writings? Now, when we start studying out the Greek word for it, we find that it occurs 5 times in the New Testament. Now, if we go back to earlier in our study, we said that the word faith occurs in 232 verses of the New Testament. However, when we begin studying it, basing Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1 as our launch board, and we take this word, which is supposed to be the definition for faith, because it's the substance, we find that it occurs in only 5 different passages of the New Testament. It occurs in Hebrews 11, 1. Hebrews, and in that passage, it is translated as substance. It is found in Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3. If someone will please find that. Hebrews 1, 3. Someone else, Hebrews 3, 14. Hebrews 3, 14. And if someone else would be willing to get 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 4. 2 Corinthians 9, 4. Hebrews 3, 14. And Hebrews 1, 3. If somebody has Hebrews 1, 3, go ahead and read it.
Who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, and he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high.
Now, I'm sure that Greek word just jumped right out at you in that passage. And the reason being is, when we look at Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3, that Greek word hypostasis was translated as person, in the brightness of his person. What about Hebrews 3:14? Hebrews 3:14. What does that verse say?
For we are
made
partakers of Christ, if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast from the end.
If we hold the beginning, and the Greek word there was used, we translated it in the New Testament as confidence. What about 2 Corinthians 9:4? The Greek word there was translated confident. So out of 5 times, and there's one verse we didn't read, but out of 5 times, or 6 verses, it was translated confident or confident 3 times. So over half the time this Greek word was used in the New Testament, it was translated as confident. So now we get a little bit clearer of an understanding that more than likely, faith is the confident or confidence of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So that substance that it's made of is more likely confidence. So faith is having confidence of things hoped for, even though we don't even see them. So that is what we come up with the biblical definition of faith.
Just try to see where I went.
There's other notes. We'll pass over them. But going a little bit farther, so faith is the confidence of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So when we have faith in God, we have confidence in Him that He's going to do things we haven't seen. So tonight when we prayed in faith. What did we pray? We prayed with confidence that to God whatsoever we asked for to his will, it was going to be done. Even though we didn't see it right now, we know that because we prayed in faith, it will be done. Not wavering, not having doubt, but we are having confidence that even though everyone has their own free will, we have confidence knowing that God's going to reach down and move on John and Shelley's heart. He is going to deal with them. He's going to convict them of their sin. What they do with that is their decision. But we pray and we know that God is going to move on. We pray that God's going to bring Pastor Holly and Sage, their family home safely. We pray. We haven't seen it yet, but we know that God's going to do it. We're not doubting. That is what faith is. Praying with the confidence of even though we haven't seen the things come to pass, that it will be done. The Bible talks, because I think there's a Greek word we didn't talk about yet, and it's important. There's two different Greek words for the word faith in the New Testament. The one we talk about dealt with substance. This deals with the word faith itself. Greek words for faith in the New Testament is pistis, and the second one is, of course I have it all here somewhere, agapistos. Why is that important? Because when we start studying it in detail, and I'm one of those guys, I'll admit it, I'll rip everything apart. It takes me longer to study something probably for some people because I like to dig, I like to dive, and I will tear things apart. And I'm no different when it comes to the Word of God. I want to know what the Word of God states for itself. I will tear it apart, I will rip it apart. Even for people that normally sit under me and might think I'm going to the extreme, I want to know what this means. So a simple verse might take me an hour or more to study. Because I'm looking at the Greek, I'm looking at the Hebrew. I am pulling it apart. I'm looking at other verses I might have memorized or come to mind. We are pulling it apart. When we look at the Greek word faith, it comes from two words in the New Testament. This is agapistos. Now this is interesting from the mere fact of if someone would please find Matthew chapter 6 and verse 30, Matthew 6, 30, and someone else Luke 12 and 28. This oligotus comes into place in James chapter 1, verses 5 through 8. Someone would please read James 5, 1 through 8. Talking about here in particular. What topic?
Faith.
Well, he's talking about prayer. When you go to make your petitions. James 5, 1 through 8. James 1, 5 through 8. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that gives to all men liberally. If you're asking God, you're praying, you're asking, you're making a petition. And when let him ask in faith. If you're asking, what are you doing? You're praying. So when we're looking at James chapter 1, verses 5 through 8, we're dealing with prayer. And when it comes to prayer, it deals with faith. Verse 6 states, let him ask in faith. Nothing wavering. So, ask in faith, nothing wavering. That implies that there is a difference between actually when you're praying, believing that something's happening or having confidence versus not having confidence. So when you pray, ask in faith, nothing wavering. So James places that distinction. And when we look at that versus what we just read there in Matthew and Luke, with the Greek word there that was used for faith, we have a rebuking of Jesus on that. O ye of little faith. James addresses it and refers to it as a double-minded man. Why do sometimes we not see things happen? It's not because we're sinning and we're trying to do one thing and live a lifestyle of the other. We're not double-minded in that regard, but we're double-minded in prayer in the fact that we believe we're going to have, but we doubt at the same time. You know, either we're sure God can do it, or we're not sure He can do it. And we go back and we go forth. And because of that, we don't have our petitions answered. Because we have asked with a lack of faith. And when we go back to go back to Luke, go back to John, go back to Matthew, the disciples were rebuked because of a lack of faith. Now, if we're going to make applications, no. Why don't we see a result? Because sometimes we're double-minded. Not that we're living a double life, not that we have sin in our life one moment and we're going back the other. It's double-minded in the fact that we're asking God to do it, not sure if He's going to, or maybe He's not. And I'm sure we've all been there and we've all done that. We've prayed, but we doubt it to a degree. You know, I've seen God do all those things. Is it God's timing? Is it God's will? No. James said that a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. If we're going to ask God in prayer and we're not sure, you know, there is an instability there. And there's also a lack of faith. And when we lack faith, we go back to the words of Jesus Christ, rebuking the disciples. O ye a little faith. They doubt. Also, we can look at a double-minded man. There's no surety of anything. There's no precision. No precision. When we pray, we have confidence. We know that God's going to do it. And there's also a more earnestness. There is also a more conciseness in our prayers. But if we're not sure, there's that going back in our own self. Is He going to do it? Is He going to do it? And when we look at faith itself, faith is not the double-minded man. It's the exact opposite. Because the double-minded man isn't sure. He isn't confident. He doesn't possess any confidence in what he's